We have three presentations today that look very interesting. So I think we'll start with Sonia. I'll take the time for 15 minutes, Sonia, and then you have like 5 minutes of buffer time. And when you reach 20 minutes, I will unmute myself and let you know it's 20 minutes. But I'll let you know when you reach 15 minutes, if that's okay. Okay, so yeah, let's start.
Okay, thank you. Hello, everyone. My name is Sonia Wolf. I'm affiliated with the drug policy program at the CIDE in Aguascalientes, Mexico. We've conducted research on forced migration from the Northern Triangle in Central America. And I wanted to give really quite an informal talk on the on our research findings. So what I'm going to say is very much based on the interviews that we conducted with migrants from Honduras, El Salvador, and Guatemala, who either were transiting Mexico because they wanted to reach the United States, or individuals who had applied for asylum in Mexico. And I think I will just mention the points I want to make also with a view to the discussion we're going to have after the presentations. It's quite a lot of material, so I can't go into too much detail. I want to focus on the drivers of forced migration, and then I will just briefly mention a few other aspects that we discussed with the migrants we interviewed. So we conducted interviews with about 130 migrants from Central America. Often these were individuals who had fled physical violence, especially by the street gangs, but also many individuals who had fled poverty, really. And so just very briefly, perhaps for those who are not too familiar with the current context in Central America. Here, I just wanted to show that really the present circumstances in Northern Central America have not changed very much over the years. You can see on the left side of the slide, the situation in the Central American countries in the past, really. So past of authoritarianism and exclusion. We can remember also the civil wars in Guatemala and El Salvador. And there was a time when peace accords were signed and the countries officially became formal democracies. But the reality nowadays is still quite different from what people had envisioned. At some point, there are still very high levels of poverty and inequality. Finding a decent job is very difficult. And one of the main problems that is often commented upon is crime and violence, including the street gangs, but not all violence is committed by the street gangs, of course. And to that, we can also add problems of governance, especially those related to corruption and also the absence of the state, which is something I want to discuss in a moment. I want to make clear, when we talk about forced migration, there are, of course, different kinds of concepts. When we speak about individuals who get displaced by some form of violence, often we speak about the internally displaced. We can also speak about refugees, so individuals who have crossed international borders. But there's often also this idea that some people are forced to leave their country, whereas others really make this decision quite voluntarily, especially when we talk about economic migrants. And so what we want to show with this research is that these are not very helpful distinctions. Of course, it may be easier to consider migration involuntary when people are fleeing physical violence, but those who live in deep poverty also really have no other choice very often but to leave their country. So we consider that there is forced migration when individuals either face a threat to their life or to their livelihood. So when really there is no other option but migration. the responses to forced migration have been problematic in Central America, but also in the transit and destination countries. So in this case, we're talking about Mexico and the United States. In very general terms, we can say that the Central American countries have been very reluctant to recognize that people are leaving because of violence. Economic migration is, of course, accepted. This has taken place for a long time. But migration due to violence, even though it is, of course, occurring, is not... not necessarily recognized by the governments in Central America. And the dominant response by Mexico and the United States has been to try to contain the flows of migrants, especially the United States has been very interested in closing its southern border, including to asylum seekers. And Mexico for a long time has played the role of a buffer state. So the migration control does not not necessarily occur at the southern border as such, but in the southern border zone and what many have called the vertical border in Mexico. So Mexico as a whole really has pursued a strategy of deterrence in order to prevent people from reaching the United States. In terms of the drivers of forced migration, really those factors are quite wide ranging. You can see in the slide that these are the factors we found through the interviews with migrants. And I would also like to add that in many cases, there was not only not just one factor present, but a range of factors. So you see, and this ranges from economic reasons, the cost of living and the difficulties to find dignified employment were often mentioned, especially by Hondurans. Related to this, also the impact of climate change in some cases, the quality or lack of quality of public services. And then we see a range of factors related to different kinds of violence. And the violence that stood out in the case of El Salvador was gang violence, which is also quite complex. Why people receive threats by the gangs, but in addition to street gang violence, some people were also threatened by criminal gangs, especially drug trafficking groups, and also violence of the state was one reason for forced migration, and problems of governance, and so. I think it is quite useful to have a look at some of the testimonies, some of the stories that individuals told us. So as I said at the beginning, there's not too much time to go into the testimonies, unfortunately. But it is clear from the stories that that migrants told us that the poverty really is very severe. So this has implications for migration policy also. States should not simply say these are poor people, we cannot help everyone, as Donald Trump has argued. But we really have to understand people's stories in order to develop more effective policies. So this is Norma, for example, from Honduras, who worked in the agricultural sector. So we can see, for example, differences between urban and rural areas, especially in the countryside. In the countryside, it is much more difficult to make a living. And Norma, for example, had to take the decision to go over to Nicaragua to do sex work, just in order to make a living and feed her children. So this is one example of the very difficult decisions that that people face. Gang extortion was a very significant problem, especially for Salvadorans, but also for Hondurans. Here we can see, for example, in El Salvador, One problem that was mentioned is not extortion in a traditional sense, gang extortion very often affects anyone who has a commercial activity, a small business, however small, but teachers in the schools are also affected. So teachers get threatened with violence if they don't give their students a passing grade. So this requires also many teachers to resign, really, and to leave their country. Moving on a little bit to the problems that individuals faced with governance on the part of the state. Admittedly, many individuals did not try to report crimes to the police because there's very little trust in the authorities. But those who did found that the police could offer no protection. So at the end, the result was very similar. Individuals had to leave their country. And so this has created a sense of frustration, feeling of injustice, of impotence in individuals because they had expected a different response from the state and were not able to receive protection when they were hoping for it. And so this is violence on the part of the state, but I would like to focus on this example from Honduras. When we started the research, we were especially interested in what is happening in local territories. So there is, of course, some research, especially by NGOs who have looked at internal forced displacement, who have tried to measure this a little bit, but we still speak in very general terms about forced migration, so both internal displacement but also outward migration, and we still know relatively little about what is happening exactly in local territories that expel people. And so what was striking was in the case of individuals who lived in gang territories, how the state was really absent, but also how this absence of the state is exploited by other actors who try to fill this gap and who try to establish their own forms of governance. So this is actually in the current moment with the coronavirus. This is what has been mentioned in several countries where criminal organizations have provided individuals with food. So the important point here is that there is a vacuum of governance. The state is absent in many local territories, and this allows other actors to step in. And so what we see in this example from Honduras is that the gangs are actually also perceived as a form of authority by local residents. So it's clear that the state is either literally not there, or people have very few expectations in terms of protection. So as in this case, when something gets stolen, for example, and people would ordinarily resort to the authorities in many gang territories, people actually go to the gangs because they feel that the gangs are more effective in resolving problems, for example, recovering stolen cell phones. So people are aware that this is not as it's not ideal, that when they resort to the gangs to resolve problems or conflicts, that they end up giving the gangs legitimacy, and people feel that this is regrettable, of course, but this is the sort of arrangement that is happening in local territories. So just to mention very briefly, when we speak about the violence that forced migrants are facing, this violence does not end when people are leaving their countries, but it actually continues also in what we call exile. So this is while they're in transit, but also in Mexico, for example, for those who have even received asylum, there are still different kinds of difficulties. So we can mention, for example, those who make this this passage to Mexico as irregular migrants, who often get assaulted in transit. But we also have to mention that people face discrimination in Mexico, even when they have a legal status, and the experiences that people make both in their countries of origin, but also in transit, while they're trying to start a new life. All this has an impact in different ways, not just the loss of homes and incomes and separation from family and friends, but also the psychological or emotional impact was quite striking. And so very briefly, we asked migrants also about their hopes for the future, and this was based also on the problems they had identified in their own countries. And so people, in a sense, identified some of the things that should change in their countries of origin, and also in Mexico, for example, that people should be more aware of the situation of migrants and should understand their rights. They should not discriminate against migrants. And of course, people said that in their countries of origin, they would like to see a reduction in poverty, in violence, the creation of more dignified jobs, better access to education and healthcare. And all this was related also to the need for better governance. And in the case of Honduras, this was perhaps the most pertinent example, because the current president of Honduras has been implicated in drug trafficking. So these are the problems that people had identified, and this also has implications for the policies that should be changed in Central America, but also in Mexico and the United States. So I will simply finish with this. We thought it was important to hear from more forced migrants themselves, how they identified the problems, hear about their experience, and use this as input for a change in policy. So just in very general terms, the way forward cannot be continued repression, also the deterrence of asylum seekers, but of course development and security need to be strengthened in Central America. But even in the best of circumstances, this would take a very long time. And now with the sanitary circumstances, this is going to be more difficult, because the necessary resources will not be there. But even though this means that countries like Mexico and the United States still have moral and legal obligations to offer options, legal options, to individuals who are fleeing different kinds of violence, be that physical violence or more structural forms of violence. And so I leave that, as I said, with a broad overview of our research, and I'll be happy to answer questions later on. Thank you.
Thank you, Sonia. That was very interesting. So we'll do the questions at the end. If you have questions, you can send them by chat, but we'll do them all together at the end. The next, Sonia, you need to stop sharing your screen. And the next, thank you. And the next presenter will be Maciel Torres Suarez. So it's 15 minutes. I'll tell you by chat when the 15 minutes are done, and then at 20, I'll tell you verbally. Is that okay?
Okay. Okay. Bueno, el trabajo que voy a presentar, la ponencia que subí a SLAS, lleva por título Vulnerabilidades dentro del proceso migratorio regular latinoamericanos con residencia temporal o permanente en México. Esta investigación forma parte de la realización de mi tesis de maestría. Desde aproximadamente un año, realmente lo que les voy a presentar es un resumen de los resultados que obtuve. Pero bueno, para hacerlo más breve, a modo de ofrecer una panorámica muy resumida del estado actual del fenómeno, bueno, me gustaría comenzar diciendo que, como todos sabemos, la migración constituye un fenómeno social que ha estado presente desde el comienzo de la vida humana. Los intereses y motivos que responden a dicho fenómeno se han ido modificando a través del tiempo, pero bueno, siempre ha sido el deseo de mejorar las condiciones de vida el motivo más frecuente entre los migrantes, ¿no? Hoy en día, a diferencia de épocas anteriores, la migración ha estado fuertemente condicionada por el fenómeno de la globalización, que ha traído consigo, entre otras cosas, una marcada aceleración y no solo una aceleración de los desplazamientos a nivel internacional, sino una marcada diferenciación de estos en relación a quiénes son los que están migrando y los tipos de movimientos que están llevando a cabo. Estos elementos han traído consigo un aumento tanto de la urgencia como de las dificultades de las políticas migratorias, sobre todo por parte de los gobiernos receptores, con el objetivo de cierta forma, reducir o evitar la proliferación descontrolada de estos desplazamientos, reclamándose a estos gobiernos respuestas políticas y reglamentaciones que tengan como último objetivo ponerle un stop, de cierta manera, al acontecimiento migratorio en relación al alto volumen que está teniendo. Dentro de esta problemática, bueno, han sido los estados las unidades fundamentales a las cuales se les ha dado la tarea de determinar la cuestión migratoria en sí, de determinar quiénes son los que entran al territorio, porque bueno, el estado es la unidad que tiene el poder inherente a su soberanía y esencial a su autopreservación de prohibir la entrada de extranjeros, y es a partir de la legislación de cada estado que quedan establecidos cuáles son los requisitos que un inmigrante debe cumplir para poder ser admitido en un estado en específico. En este contexto, bueno, no es de extrañar que muchas de estas legislaciones han tenido un carácter marcadamente excluyente. Y bueno, a partir de esta exclusión se ha comenzado a hablar desde hace algunas décadas de que el inmigrante se entiende como un sujeto socialmente vulnerable debido a su condición de relativa desprotección por parte de los recursos institucionales de la sociedad de destino. Esta situación de vulnerabilidad se ha visto expresada sobre todo en el desamparo institucional que se produce desde el Estado receptor, considerando los riesgos que acompañan a los migrantes y reconociendo que son personas que se enfrentan a contextos sobre los que de cierta forma no tienen en poder, dependen de las disposiciones del Estado establecidas en materia de migración para determinar qué derechos tengo y qué no en la sociedad a la que llego. Desde esta concepción, desde la concepción de vulnerabilidad, se ha puesto énfasis en resaltar que cualquier inmigrante es un individuo socialmente vulnerable simplemente por su condición de migración, aunque obviamente el grado de vulnerabilidad al que pueda presentar esta persona va a estar marcada, condicionada por diversos aspectos, donde destacan sobre todo aspectos sociodemográficos como edad, etnia, sexo, escolaridad, situación migratoria, capital social en relación a las redes sociales que tengan o no los sujetos para llevar a cabo el proyecto migratorio, nacionalidad, país de acogida, etc. Dicho grado va a estar determinado por las políticas migratorias y por la baja capacidad institucional por parte de los estados receptores para garantizar la seguridad y el pleno respeto a la dignidad de cualquier migrante, ¿no? A pesar de lo anterior, en materia de vulnerabilidad migratoria, han sido los inmigrantes irregulares los que tradicionalmente se han vuelto objeto de estudio dentro del fenómeno migratorio, debido a que su condición no regularizada implica que no puedan beneficiarse de todos los derechos ni estén en condiciones de cumplir todos los deberes. Obviamente, los migrantes irregulares, en relación a los regulares, tienen una posición de desventaja, una posición aún más desventajosa en la sociedad de destino, porque ya parten del hecho de que no están siendo reconocidos, al menos políticamente, por parte de esta sociedad. Sin embargo, aunque bueno, se sobreentiende que el por qué ha sido esta población la que se ha vuelto objeto de estudio en relación a los estudios entre migración y vulnerabilidad. En esta investigación, la inquietud surgía de preguntarse, ¿no?, qué está sucediendo con los inmigrantes irregulares. ¿Acaso estos no son también vulnerables? Ya que, bueno, pese a que los irregulares pasan por un proceso migratorio que trae consigo una serie de complejidades y situaciones negativas que llegan a atentar contra sus vidas en muchísimas ocasiones, eso no desquita que, bueno, que el proyecto migratorio para los regulares sea del todo favorable. A modo de responder estas preguntas, esta inquietud, que a partir de la cual surgió esta investigación, se decidió enfocar el estudio en el caso de México en específico. Y bueno, la selección de este país se justificó por varias cosas, pero bueno, lo principal es que la migración en esta nación ha tenido una presencia constante. Este fenómeno es intrínseco del devenir de su desarrollo y ha formado parte consustancial de la evolución de la nación, adquiriendo singulares repercusiones demográficas, económicas, políticas y sociales, sobre todo en la última década, donde ha habido un incremento de la población extranjera en estancia regular dentro de todo el territorio nacional. Y bueno, han sido los inmigrantes provenientes de la región latinoamericana los que han tenido una mayor presencia en territorio mexicano. Específicamente es en la Ciudad de México donde se ha tendido a concentrar el mayor grueso de esta población. Y bueno, la selección de esta ciudad en específico como contexto de destino se justifica por varios elementos, fundamentalmente porque, bueno, es la capital del país, en comparación con otros estados del territorio, ofrece mejores condiciones laborales, más oportunidades de empleo, y bueno, en este sentido no es de extrañar que los colectivos de migrantes visualicen este territorio como un lugar para mejorar sus condiciones de vida en cuanto a la inserción en un mercado laboral que les posibilite mejorar estas condiciones. En relación al tema específico de vulnerabilidad, cuando se habla de vulnerabilidad en México, cobra importancia la posición actual adoptada por el Estado mexicano frente a la movilidad internacional, como consecuencia de ese incremento, lo mismo que pasa a nivel internacional, y bueno, mediante la cual la vulnerabilidad se ha expresado por medio de la interacción de estos inmigrantes con los contextos institucionales de la nación mexicana, específicamente mediante la interacción con el poder del Estado. Las disposiciones derivadas de este poder quedan establecidas explícitamente en la política migratoria del Estado mexicano, fundamentada en los principios generales y demás preceptos contenidos en su Ley de Migración de 2011, la ley actual, y es el Instituto Nacional de Migración del país, conocido como el INM, la entidad que representa este poder en materia migratoria, y son los funcionarios de estos institutos, las autoridades que establecen en última instancia quién reside o no en México de manera regular. Desde las disposiciones y normativas establecidas en esta ley de migración, cuyo propósito fundamental es privilegiar una migración congruente, destacando la dignidad y el respeto de los migrantes, en este estudio se parte de la inquietud de preguntarse si a partir de esta ley, en cuestiones de vulnerabilidad, se garantiza o no la inmunidad de aquellos que migran de manera regular, quienes buscan cumplir con todos los requisitos establecidos en aras de obtener una residencia regular en el país. Con el propósito de responder estas preguntas, en este trabajo se consideró pertinente analizar el proceso que tienen que llevar a cabo los inmigrantes latinoamericanos para residir regularmente en México. El enfoque se pone en los trámites que realizan ante esta institución. Me gustaría decir que, bueno, realmente la vulnerabilidad es un concepto muy amplio, no solo está enfocado o limitado a los trámites que hace un migrante para poder residir o no en un contexto determinado, realmente abarca más allá de estos trámites, ¿no? Y también está relacionado con el posterior proceso de integración social y laboral de estos sujetos en los contextos de llegada. Sin embargo, aquí se consideró pertinente como realmente muy pocos estudios acerca de migración y vulnerabilidad en contextos regulares. Consideré pertinente enfocar el análisis hacia estos trámites en específico, ya que, bueno, los mismos también constituyen una antesala que de cierta forma marcan esta posterior inserción en los contextos de llegada, ¿no? Sabemos que el tener o no un tipo de residencia, el tipo de residencia que se tenga y si se está regular o no, inexorablemente influye sobre las condiciones posteriores de vida en estas sociedades receptoras en relación a la integración social, la integración laboral, la integración cultural, en relación al reconocimiento de los derechos que puedes tener en estos escenarios. Entonces, por eso, al hacer este un estudio de caso de tipo exploratorio, decidí concentrarme más bien en este tipo parte de, dentro del proceso migratorio, en esta parte dentro del proceso migratorio. Y bueno, se planteaba como hipótesis que los inmigrantes regulares en esta nación son vulnerables debido a su condición de susceptibilidad y subordinación frente a una institución que representa el poder del Estado, que es el INM, y que tiene total autoridad para hacer cumplir con los requisitos establecidos por la política migratoria mexicana vigente en aras de tocar o no residencias regulares. Este es un estudio de caso, como dije, de tipo exploratorio, y se seleccionó para su realización a un grupo de 1000 inmigrantes latinoamericanos. Bueno, me quedé con los inmigrantes latinoamericanos específicamente porque son los que tienen mayor representación en el país y bueno, en la Ciudad de México. Y bueno, a partir del año 2013, porque es el año a partir del cual empieza a operar como tal la ley de migración de 2011. Y bueno, a estos inmigrantes se les aplicó un cuestionario diseñado específicamente para la investigación que recogía un número importante de preguntas, aproximadamente 100 preguntas. El cuestionario se realizó por Google Drive en un periodo de 6 meses más o menos. Y bueno, estas preguntas buscaban determinar si los inmigrantes tenían o no dificultades en la realización de sus trámites, y no solo el tipo de dificultades que tenían, sino identificar a raíz de estas dificultades el nivel de vulnerabilidad al que estaban expuestos en relación a la obtención de una residencia regular aquí en el país. Y bueno, a través de las preguntas realizadas, se construyeron, bueno, realmente, como dije, fueron aproximadamente 100 preguntas las que se hicieron en el cuestionario, preguntas de respuestas cerradas. Aquí, debido al tiempo o disposición, solo voy a presentar aquellas que resumen la información obtenida y que, bueno, son las más importantes y que revelan, manifiestan la vulnerabilidad dentro de este colectivo. Pero bueno, realmente en el documento, la ponencia que subí, estaba mucho más explícito todo lo que se llevó a cabo para poder obtener los resultados de la investigación. Y bueno, las preguntas, las variables que se construyeron a partir de las preguntas más importantes dentro del cuestionario, la primera era si los inmigrantes tenían dificultad en la página oficial con la página oficial del Instituto Nacional de Migración, ya que en esta página es que se establece cuáles son los requisitos que debe cumplir un migrante para poder obtener un tipo de residencia regular. Tenían dificultad en la documentación a presentar una vez que se dirigían al instituto para obtener las residencias, si tenían dificultad con los funcionarios del INM en relación a la interrelación que se establece entre estos funcionarios y los inmigrantes, y por último se construyó una variable que agrupaba estas tres, que son tres variables igual de resumen, pero se construyó otra que era una variable más general que agrupaba las tres anteriores para determinar si existía no vulnerabilidad dentro del proceso migratorio que van a cabo estos sujetos. Y bueno, en relación a los resultados obtenidos, primero en cuanto a estas tres primeras variables, en cuanto a la dificultad para realizar trámites, para la dificultad en cuanto a la información que revela la página oficial del INM, el 82.3% de los encuestados manifestó que tenían dificultad al no entender qué era lo que plantean, que la información que evidencia esta página no es muy clara, no es muy completa, y bueno, eso influía posteriormente en la segunda, en otras preguntas que se hicieron, a partir de la cual se construyó la variable documentación, dificultad en la documentación a presentar, que el 74% manifestó que sí, debido a que no tenían muy claro cuáles eran los requisitos a presentar, no se entendían qué tipo de requisitos estaban solicitando, cuando llegaban a la institución pedían otros, y muchas veces, bueno, este proceso influía en que no podían obtener las residencias a las cuales estaban aplicando, aún cumpliendo con los requisitos que en un inicio estaba pidiendo la institución. Y la tercera variable era problemas derivados con la funcionalidad del INM, en relación al trabajo que realizan los funcionarios, la información que brindan estos, el trato que dan, que desafortunadamente es muy desfavorable, el lenguaje que utilizan, el tiempo que deben emplear los encuestados para resolver un trámite, el horario de cierre de la institución, las notificaciones que deben enviar sobre los trámites, el tiempo de resolución de los mismos, las dificultades para solicitar ayuda por no saber a dónde dirigirse, el monto pagado, el desconocimiento sobre las categorías migratorias que maneja la institución, y en el caso de los residentes temporales, el miedo a caer en una situación de indocumentación una vez que venciera su residencia temporal por no saber qué tipo de tramitación hacer para poder mantener la estancia regular aquí en México. Y obviamente, en relación a estos puntos, el 65.3% de la muestra manifestó presentar dificultades al respecto. Y bueno, después se intentó determinar no solo quiénes habían presentado dificultades, sino el nivel de esta dificultad, que bueno, de cierta manera se traduce en el grado de vulnerabilidad que están expuestos estos sujetos. Y bueno, el 83.1% de la muestra, que se considera un porcentaje bastante alto, manifestó presentar una mucha dificultad en la realización de estos trámites, y un gran porcentaje de ellos incluso expresó que debido a esta dificultad han quedado en situación de irregularidad aquí en México, han tenido que regresarse a sus países de origen, y vuelvo y repito, aún cumpliendo con los requisitos que plantea la ley de migración y demás. Y bueno, por último, vuelvo y repito, esto es un panorama bastante breve sobre los resultados que obtuve, pero bueno, ya por último, también crucé la variable vulnerabilidad con las características sociodemográficas de los encuestados, ya que, bueno, la vulnerabilidad es un concepto que está atravesado por este tipo de cuestiones más personales, más sociodemográficas, por lo que se suponía que el grado de vulnerabilidad podía variar atendiendo a estas consideraciones, ¿no? Y bueno, los resultados del estudio revelaron que estos eran los grupos más vulnerables en cuanto a la realización de los trámites: las personas con bajo nivel educacional, aquellos que contaban con categorías de estudiantes o de dependientes familiares, las mujeres, los jóvenes, los centroamericanos andinos y los que tenían una menor presencia aquí en México. Con respecto a la nacionalidad, bueno, desafortunadamente, incluso antes del desarrollo de la investigación se suponía que iba a haber cierta... una mayor vulnerabilidad en relación a estos grupos, de sobre todo de centroamericanos, ya que bueno, la migración, la historia migratoria que han tenido estos grupos y su relación con México ha sido bastante, se ha interpretado por parte no solo de los políticos, sino de la sociedad mexicana en general, como un proceso migratorio bastante desfavorable, y esto se ha traducido también en la relación que han establecido los funcionarios migratorios del instituto con este tipo de migrantes en específico que provienen de Centroamérica, quienes incluso en relación con los andinos resultaron ser los más desfavorecidos dentro de este proceso. Muchas veces se les niega la residencia aún cumpliendo con los requisitos. Y bueno, eso es todo. Esto es un estudio exploratorio. Realmente lo que quiero con él es tratar de poner sobre el tapete, ¿no?, una realidad que es compleja, que no se puede desestimar y que no se debe asumir que el hecho de ser un migrante irregular ignora que seas un migrante vulnerable, ¿no? Y me gustaría completar aún más esta investigación, no solo en el caso de México, sino en el caso de otros países, y a modo de también ofrecer una comparación para, de cierta manera, buscar políticas, que se establezcan políticas que busquen que los migrantes regulares sean menos vulnerables en el proceso de tramitación, ¿no?, a la hora de residir en un contexto u otro. Y ya eso sería todo. Muchas gracias.
Muchas gracias, Maciel. Thank you very much. Now we have the final presentation, and then we'll have like almost 40 minutes for comments and questions, so it'll be a nice conversation. The last presentation is by Gabriela García. Are you ready?
Sí, yeah, I mean, yes. Yes, okay, I'm ready, so Alejandra.
You have 15 minutes and I'll let you know by chat. And then five extra, so 20.
Thank you, that's great. Right. Okay. Second. Okay, so thank you all for joining us. I know these are very challenging and difficult times for everyone. So thank you for making the effort and holding it until today. I know we're in the last session and I'm the last presenter, so hope you don't get bored. So for today's presentation, I had adapted a little bit my initial paper idea for the conference, and I have only focused on securitization. I will not be talking about invisibility. And today's presentation's title is Exclusion Encounters and Threatening Others: Securitization of Colombian Asylum Seekers and Refugees in Ecuador. And this is, I'm sharing just a little bit of my findings from my PhD research. I conducted 40 interviews, but of course I will just share a little bit of these interviews. And also I had some funding from SLAS. I conducted two rounds of fieldwork in 2018 and 2019. So I will go briefly over the context of South America and human mobility. Later on, an outline of my theoretical framework and an introduction to the case of Colombian asylum seekers and refugees in Ecuador. And finally, to share my findings with you and have some concluding remarks in the end. So for those of you who are not familiar perhaps so much with the dynamics of migration in South America, well, the flows are predominantly intra-regional. And just to contextualize a little bit for the case study that I will be sharing with you today, from the early 2000s until 2015, more or less around that year, this very interesting movement in the region occurred, whereby governments from the center-left or left arrived into power to Bolivia, for example, Argentina, Venezuela, Ecuador with Rafael Correa, and so on. But the most important thing about this movement or post-neoliberal wave, like some academics have labeled it, or pink tide as well, is that alongside with this ideological move in the region came as well a discourse of human rights for the migrant, or what has been acknowledged as the rights-based discourse for the migrant. So placing human mobility, emigration, immigration, and asylum in the center of the policies of the region. And this happened more rhetorically in multilateral spaces like the South American Conference on Migration, Mercosur, Cannes forums, and so on. The countries adopted these rights-based discourse at varying levels, and Argentina, for example, 2004, they changed their immigration law, and most recently, Brazil, Ecuador, and Chile adopted as well their immigration laws. But the most salient point about this movement in the region is that in 2008, Ecuador, during the Rafael Correa presidency, changed the constitution to incorporate this bundle of rights and principles that replicated to an extent this rights-based discourse at regional level. So the constitution recognized the right to migrate, for example. I think it's the first constitution or the only one that the acknowledge or recognizes this right. Whether we know the scope of that recognition in practice is a different issue. But yes, the constitution recognized the right to migrate, the prohibition of the criminalization of migration, the prohibition of discrimination for migratory status, for example, and including the principle of universal citizenship in their international relations. So these constitutional changes were significant in terms of human mobility. Now, alongside these changes in the region and as well in Ecuador, there were restrictive responses on Ecuadorian and South American immigrants in the EU as well as the US. And we can name as an example the EU Returns Directive, for instance. And so the regional discourse as well as Ecuador's discourse worked as counter discourse to these restrictive measures in the north. However, from 2011 on, in Ecuador specifically, that is the case I will be focusing on, the reemergence of this restrictive, not only language, but also policies arrived to the country. And yeah, so this is the focus of my research. I want to understand how the receiving countries and the governmental elites in these receiving countries construct the refugee or asylum population as a security threat. So I'm really interested in this threat construction process. And in order to answer that question, how refugees or asylum seekers are constructed as security issues, I draw from securitization theory, or I'm imagining some of you may already heard the term securitization of migration. So in sum, the securitization of migration is to explore how migrants or refugees or asylum seekers become a security issue. And the theory can work for any other issue for that matter. This is a constructivist approach. And following a little bit of a more contemporary take on securitization, I adopt Balzac's work from 2011. So for this work, securitization is context dependent, it's intersubjective because it involves securitizing actors that for my research are governmental elites, and other relevant audiences who negotiate this meaning of threat that is ascribed to the asylum seeker or refugee population. And this operates through multiple practices that I have operationalized as discourses and security tools. So the data I've collected are interviews, as I mentioned at the beginning, and also I analyze legal and official documents for that matter. So now, in terms of the case study, Colombian asylum seekers have been arriving to Ecuador since around the year 2000. So there is this quite long-standing tradition of seeking for protection in Ecuador. And at the time of the analysis, the period of the study I will be analyzing is 2012 and 2017 for today's presentation. So at that time, there were discussions of around 200,000 people, Colombians, in need of international protection. So bearing that in mind, the Ecuadorian government, part of that rights-based discourse that I mentioned at the beginning, instated a mass registration program, or the official name is the Enhanced Registration Program, or Registro Ampliado, through which 30,000 Colombians in need of international protection were recognized between 2009 and 2010. So as we can see here, I have shared this graph with some statistics on the recognition of Colombians. This is actually the total amount of applications recognized in Ecuador. But we can see the peak here, and this is the peak that corresponds to the Registro Ampliado, or the registration program. So we can see a huge peak here between 2009 and 2010, in comparison, for example, to the historical recognitions from 1989 until 2006, for instance. So what happened here was that 98 to 96% of the total cases were from Colombia. And what happened here was that this open doors discourse, you know, the constitutional changes alongside the mass registration program, it received certain backlash from governmental sectors as well as the receiving society. And as you can see here, the decline in recognitions, this is just an indication of how the governmental discourse evolved from or mutated from a rights-based approach into a securitization approach. So one of the findings I have from the interviews as well as the legal documents that I have analyzed is that there is a salient infiltrations discourse. In this picture, for example, this was taken during the registration program. We can see how that openness to recognition of Colombians in need of protection then received this backlash, and the infiltrations discourse focused around the criticisms on that registration program. So we could see another salient theme that I could find was the abuse of asylum system, and then an association between being a refugee or asylum seeker from Colombia recognized in that registration program with criminality. And as an example here, I have included one declaration from President Correa, through which he created these categories of bogus asylum seekers and refugees and legitimate asylum seekers and refugees, when he, for example, says that that it will be strictly revised so that refugee status is recognized to those who truly deserve it, before the process was too flexible and that has been rectified. So he's referring specifically to this mass registration program. So he also mentions the deficiencies, the abuses, and the lack of control of in this process of recognition. And later on, he also makes associations of criminality when he refers to delinquents that have sought asylum and they become refugees. So this was coming to an end. In one of my interviews, someone who was present in these registration program brigades shared with me their experience during the time in the aftermath of the recognition, when there was all these, the emergence of these infiltrations discourse. He said, every night, every bus that passed was stopped. Sniffer dogs searched the luggage on the bus. They looked for weapons, drugs, and migrants. So he asked, what are you looking for? And they replied, weapons, drugs, and migrants. So here we can see this association between drug smuggling, weapons smuggling, as well as migration. So this discourse of infiltrations was reaffirmed as well through the deployment of security tools. And here I have cited just a few examples. The first is Operation Identity. This was a migration control operation that worked through raids and deportation schemes. This occurred in 2011. So it was like the preamble to the more restrictive approach to arrive to Ecuador. So as a product of Operation Identity, there were around 200 migrants detained and then deported, and the majority of them were Colombians. And some of them also had sought for asylum. So this was a moment of where that infiltration discourse was becoming more clear. Now, the biggest tool or the most significant tool that resembles this infiltration discourse is Decree 1182, or Decreto 1182. Through this decree, the extended definition of asylum seeker was removed. So this impacted directly Colombian applicants because their cases would fit onto generalized violence category, which responded to the extended definition. In addition to that, the time frame to lodge applications was established in 15 days, which according to activists, academics, and as well the population, of course, 15 days to lodge an asylum application was unreasonable considering the circumstances in which asylum seekers fled Colombia. In addition to that, the decree instated this admissibility phase, like a filter, so that the case was not heard if they did not comply with these requirements, these additional categories, in order to filter applications. And another tool that was incorporated via the decree was the removal of a status. So even if asylum seekers and refugees had passed all these filters that had been recognized as asylum seekers or as refugees, their status could have been removed if they were considered a threat to national security or public order. So in these circumstances, there were risks of deportation and detention. So given that the Constitution had this rights-based approach and this decree contradicted some of these provisions, if not most of the provisions on human mobility, civil servants that dealt with asylum applications during the process had what we call discretionary interpretation. And this discretion or discretionary interpretation meant that, as one interviewee said in one of our meetings, if you were unlucky and had a restrictive civil servant in charge of your case, then you would very unlikely be recognized as an asylum seeker. So this is just as an example of how discretionary interpretation operated in these tensions between the Constitution and this decree. So these infiltrations discourse that construct asylum seekers, Colombians as threatening others, was also present in the interviews that I conducted with some civil servants from the Ministry of Foreign Affairs, as well as the Ministry of Interior. So for example, someone referred to the profile of refugee, someone referred to applicants not complying with the profile of refugee, using the system to avoid paying fines, and sometimes maybe committing crimes. So once again, reiterating that category of bogus asylum seeker, bogus applicant, and legitimate asylum seeker, and then an association with committing a crime and criminality. And then this other quote was really interesting from someone from the Ministry of Interior, who actually constructed another category of desirable and undesirable migrant. So this person said that the best type of citizen does not arrive, the professional, but rather the citizen with criminal records, the dangerous, in a heavy situation of poverty, and so on. So this association of infiltration also goes in hand with these perceptions of criminality. And just to, I'm coming to the end to the presentation, these constructions of asylum seekers from Colombia and refugees as well as threatening others were also reverberated in the public opinion. So for example, in Ecuador, Las Americas y El Mundo from 2012 and 2014, the population surveyed agreed that foreigners caused insecurity, that they took jobs. Predominantly, they had bad or very bad opinion about Colombians, and Colombians being the most rejected nationality. And as well, they favored securitizing measures such as border controls, deportations, and in lesser extent, walls. Also, academic work point out that specific stereotypes associated to being Colombian asylum seeker refugee associated to criminality, drug trafficking, guerrilla, and gender stereotypes for Colombian women. And yes, this is one of my last points as well. These shared perceptions also are experienced in the lives of the refugees. While this is not the main focus of my research, I thought it would be important to include a little bit of the impact of these securitizing discourses and also tools that have been deployed. So for example, in another work that I did in 2016, Jenny and Alfonso shared their experience of being shouted at on the street saying that they are drug traffickers and that they came to Ecuador to do that. So this is just a very small indication of the experiences of discrimination and xenophobia that the refugee and asylum seeking population from Colombia goes through. So in this context, the population has been seeking anonymity, other alternatives of regularization, such as Mercosur visa as well. And just to close my presentation, linking to the arrival of new groups of refugees and of asylum seekers and migrants, for example, from Venezuela, they prefer to adopt invisibility, and also because the governmental discourse co-opt or focus the attention on other groups of migrants as well. And yes, with this, I just want to conclude that securitization occurred in this case. This threat construction process resembled this discourse of infiltrations, of the abuse of asylum system, amending previous errors from this registration program, associations to irregularity and criminality. And these security tools were mainly of regulatory nature, such as the decree that I just mentioned. And these perceptions of threat were shared, not just in governmental elites, also in my interviewees and the relevant audiences as well. Thank you very much.
Thank you, that was great. So now we have 35 minutes for questions. So what I think we could do is, if anyone has any questions, you could write it in the chat, or if you want to ask it like speaking, you can write in the chat, I want to ask a question, and then I can say, go ahead. But if no one has a question immediately, I can start like the ball rolling with some, okay, so Esteban has a question. Okay, so Esteban, go ahead, ask your question.
Yeah. Okay, thank you very much. I had a question for Gabriela. So I was interested, you were talking about desirable and undesirable migrants. So I was wondering whether you looked at race and class, taking into account who was desirable and undesirable. And then maybe, well, I don't know if there'll be time, but I was actually very interested in your last comment at the end about invisibility with the new migrants. But obviously, if there's time for that one.
Oh, thank you very much, Esteban, for your question. Yes, I definitely must take into account class and race, and not just because of this quote that I just showed you, but because this is a salient finding as well. Although this is not the main focus of my thesis, of my project at the moment, I do acknowledge that the intersections of all these vectors of inequality work together, ascribing or constructing migrant, in this case, asylum seekers and refugees in this light. So yeah, thank you very much for that note. Yes, I do, and it's not the main focus. I wish it was now. It will be probably in my more critical work that I want to do in the future as well. And in regards to invisibility, yes, I think in the interviews, and I couldn't include them because it was too much, but I do include this in my thesis. It was a salient theme as well in the interviewees. I didn't interview directly refugees or migrants because my focus is more state-centric. I look at governmental elites, but I complemented this view with activists as well from NGOs who work with the migrant and refugee population. And in several interviews, it came up that since 2017, actually more saliently since 2018, 2019, they know that Colombians are still seeking for protection, and the figures of the Ministry of Foreign Affairs, although questionable, they do give us an indication. And there were, for example, in 2018, for example, from 2018 until to 2020, there were 4,000 applications filed, mostly by Colombians. So from that side, they are still arriving. They are still in need of protection. However, the focus, due to as well ideological reasons, not only in Ecuador but also I think in the region, the magnitude of the displacement of Venezuelans has centered all the attention on that. And if we talk about integration policies, for example, for Colombians who have been over 18, 20 years in the country, the attention has geared towards integration, first of all, towards regularization efforts for Venezuelans. I know Jeffrey Pugh and others wrote a blog piece on this interplay between the arrival of Venezuelans and also Colombians in Ecuador. And I think this would be something really interesting to explore further. But yes, my informants tell me the population is still there. The population is still in need. I wanted to add as well, there are some projects that were already funded in some NGOs to cater specifically to Colombians in Ecuador, but it was difficult for these organizations to reach the population, but we know they are still there. So it's something really, really interesting right there. I don't know if I answered your question or I rambled, but I think, this is what I can share about this point. Yeah.
Thank you, Gabriela. Now I'll read a question that Gerardo González sent. He has one for Maciel and one for Gabriela, but I think we could do Maciel's and then maybe one for Sonia, and then we read, because I think you kind of answered it. So the first one is, saludos desde Caracas, Venezuela. Mi pregunta es para Maciel. Dentro de los resultados de la encuesta, ¿hubo diferencias significativas entre las nacionalidades? ¿Puedes comentar si hay algo que recuerdes sobre los venezolanos? Gracias. And Gabriela, read the other question and think about it for later. Okay. Maciel?
Creo que está puesto. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Yes.
Sí, hubo grandes diferencias por nacionalidades. Bueno, realmente en la exposición no pude ahondar mucho sobre eso, pero sí fueron de los resultados más interesantes. Bueno, se partía de la hipótesis de que sí iba a haber mayor o menor vulnerabilidad tendiendo al lugar, al país de procedencia de los sujetos. Y bueno, yo agrupé la muestra de los 1,000 encuestados por regiones de América Latina, para hacer primero la diferenciación por región, y los venezolanos caían en la región andina, que era de la región más vulnerable junto con los centroamericanos realmente, los que menos manifestaron tener problemas a la hora de realizar sus trámites fueron los sudamericanos, particularmente los chilenos y argentinos. Aquí en México, en la Ciudad de México, hay muchísimos argentinos, y realmente el trato con ellos y demás, también relacionado con el nivel educacional que tienen, reveló que la obtención de residencia por parte de este colectivo es un proceso mucho más favorable. Y en el caso del grupo de los andinos, donde destacan los venezolanos, de hecho fueron los que presentaron mayores problemas. Actualmente aquí hay muchísimos grupos de venezolanos que están llegando de manera regular, no es que llegan de manera irregular, hay muchísimos que están llegando por motivos de estudio, con becas de estudio, por motivos de trabajo, bueno, por la situación que sabemos que hay en Venezuela. Y realmente relacionado con este aumento de hace un par de años para acá de la población venezolana aquí en México, y particularmente en la Ciudad de México, se ha producido cierto rechazo en el Instituto de Migración hacia este colectivo. Uno se dirige hacia ese colectivo, hacia el instituto, y hice observación participante allí, y realmente es de los inmigrantes que más hay, ¿no? Y tienen muy mala opinión acerca del trato que les ofrecen, de todo en general, del proceso en general que tienen que llevar a cabo para poder establecerse aquí regularmente. Incluso, como digo, vienen con ofertas de estudio, con ofertas de trabajo, por lo que en un inicio se supone que cumplen con todos los requisitos para acceder a estas categorías migratorias, pero desafortunadamente muchos les cuesta acceder a estas categorías, y hay algunos que, como dije, caen en la irregularidad por no poder acceder a las mismas. Particularmente en el caso de los venezolanos, fue muy evidente estos resultados. Incluso, desde que aumentó la población de venezolanos aquí, los requisitos para el examen, para la obtención de la ciudadanía mexicana, bueno, para nacionalizarse como mexicano aquí en México, en el colectivo, para el colectivo de latinoamericanos, solo se necesitan 2 años de residencia aquí en el país, y realmente desde que aumentó la población venezolana aquí, el examen, el nivel de complejidad del examen ha aumentado muchísimo, con el objetivo, con el propósito de que no hayan tantos latinoamericanos nacionalizándose como mexicanos, a raíz del boom que ha habido, no solo del aumento de la población venezolana, sino de otros colectivos como los cubanos, argentinos, aquí en el país, pero bueno, todo ha sido también a raíz del aumento de las personas provenientes de Venezuela. No sé si respondí tu pregunta, espero que...
Muchas gracias, Maciel.
Por nada.
Gerardo dice, excelente respuesta.
Gracias.
I have a question for Sonia. I think it's very interesting, and I know you didn't have a lot of time to explain where you interviewed people and whatever, and as you know, I also study Central American migration. And a thing that I forgot to ask when I was doing my own research, which seems important now, is to know the process of migration internally. So I was wondering, do you know if these people had like rural urban migration and then international migration, or what were the migration like steps before they did the transit migration? Because I didn't ask that, but I think it's a very interesting question.
Yes. It is a very relevant question, and we did ask about that, especially well, not just individuals who were fleeing gang violence, also people who were living in poverty, who were trying to find a job elsewhere. So especially those who left, more strictly speaking, because of poverty, they were often trying to find jobs elsewhere. So there was some internal relocation in the country. This is more difficult for individuals who are fleeing violence, because the Central American countries are so small, right? So people can't really relocate internally. We can make this distinction. Individuals who left more for reasons of structural violence, they did try to relocate internally, but those who were fleeing physical violence, they didn't really have that option, because the gangs are networked and they can find people or track them down internally. So in those cases, people, there were some cases of internal relocation, but people generally were tracked down. There was no way to live safely in their country, so they often had to leave. Sometimes those periods were a little longer, but often they were given only 24 hours, especially by the gangs. That is very common, 24 hours to leave their house and their community, and so they went elsewhere. Perhaps what's also interesting is that some people mentioned that they had thought of going elsewhere. So we know that Mexico and especially the United States are the countries that people from Central America often look to. Especially the United States, many Central Americans find Mexico not to be very different from the Central American countries. So they feel there's also insecurity because of the drug trafficking groups. There's also corruption. And many migrants mentioned that they thought Mexico was not very attractive in economic terms. So the US dollar was really the incentive to make it to the United States. But even so, some people had mentioned that they had thought of going elsewhere. And so those cases were especially Costa Rica, Nicaragua, also Belize in one case. Nicaragua, that was before the conflict there started, the protests against the Ortega government. But generally, if we look at those experiences, really the common denominator was that, especially in Costa Rica and Nicaragua, it is relatively easy for people to obtain asylum, also fairly quick compared to Mexico and certainly the United States. But then the problem is finding work. So people, again, cannot make a living in those contexts. And this then prompted people to make their way to Mexico or hoping to get into the United States. Yeah, so this is really a bit of a long answer, but I think that there is quite a lot of information there if we look for it. So it's not as simple as simply, you know, leaving the country of origin and going to, you know, straight up to Mexico or the United States, but the experiences are actually a little bit more complex.
That's very interesting, Sonia. Thank you. So if no one else has a question right now, there was a question for Gabriela from Gerardo. ¿Encontraste alguna evidencia dentro de la narrativa que se hacía de los refugiados colombianos, del trabajo que hacen, el lenguaje que utilizan las agencias multilaterales, especialmente ACNUR o la Organización Internacional de las Migraciones? Are these important?
Yes, thank you, Gerardo, for your question. I think it is very important. I did find, interestingly, in the narrative, because my focus is more state-centric, so I mainly look at governmental elites and how this happens from the state, right? But in this narrative from the Ecuadorian government, I did find that when they were portraying themselves as human rights or protectors, this is how I named this discourse, the human rights protectors discourse, and they were taking this discourse to multilateral spaces as well. Even, for example, the president went to the General Assembly and then he threw in his protectors discourse. They also did this in multilateral spaces in the region as well. What I did notice in relation to what you point out on the UNHCR in this case is that this self-perception of protector was reiterated as well by the UNHCR. They praised the work of Ecuador, of course, after the enhanced registration program, that they indeed recognized thousands of people that needed protection. But also as these restrictive responses were being implemented. So it was really interesting, for example, that the UNHCR praised the work that Ecuador was doing in 2013 in the aftermath of that restrictive decree that they just instated in 2012. So while my focus is not to look at how these agencies construct or how their role in this construction of this perception of threat, I do think this is really, really interesting and important as well in this sense. And then something else I could add to this is that there were some terms that, well, as I also worked on the field as an immigration asylum lawyer in Ecuador. So from that point of view, and not my academic expertise, but from my interaction on the field, I noticed problematic terms like person of interest. So when there were projects that had to be geared towards the Colombian population, for instance, we had to go through a process of evaluating to what extent the vulnerabilities that Maciel mentioned, for example, but in relation to this population, forcibly displaced. Yes, terminology like person of interest was really, really, I don't know, for me problematic and quite arbitrary. So yes, that's all I can say in relation to your question. Yeah, that's all. Thank you very much for your question, Gerardo.
Thank you, Gabriela. Now we have a question for Sonia. Also for you, but let's do Sonia first. How the new US government affected the perception that these migrants had of the US?
Thank you. So we did ask, as I mentioned earlier, not just about the experiences of migrants in the country of origin, but also the situation in Mexico and perspectives of their future, either in Mexico or the United States. So as I said in response to Alejandra's question, for people, it's still very important to find safety in the case of those who are fleeing gang violence, but also to have a decent income for themselves and for their families. That was very important in many cases, especially Hondurans, also Guatemalans and some Salvadorans, but let's say those who were fleeing poverty, who had not been able to find jobs in Central America, for them it was very important to find a job. And they thought, even if the economic situation in Mexico was not very favorable, it was still slightly better than in Central America, but certainly the United States was really the destination that many wanted to reach. Interestingly, also several migrants or refugees who had either applied for asylum or who had already received asylum in Mexico, they still had this idea of wanting to reach the United States. So that in very general terms, this hope of reaching the United States didn't change despite the Trump administration, but people had become aware, of course, especially the individuals that we talked to in the migrant shelters in Mexico. They had heard, of course, that things had become more difficult at the U.S.-Mexico border, and they weren't sure if they were going to make it to the other side. But they were at least they wanted to try to get to the other side. So in terms of when you ask about perceptions, it really people mentioned Donald Trump, of course, a lot. They thought that he was someone who didn't understand the situation migrants from Central America were in. And this was also, just to mention very briefly, there was also a component in our research where we asked people why they had decided to participate in our research and how they felt about it. And so for many migrants, it was important to participate in research in order to tell their story, because they felt that was one way of sensitizing people, but also they were hoping that these stories through the researchers would eventually reach policymakers, and that this might have an impact on migration policy. But so especially the migrants we interviewed in migrant shelters, they were aware of the difficulties at the border, and that the Trump administration was making it very difficult for people to cross to the other side or to or even to obtain asylum, but they were still hoping to be able to get in. So there were obstacles, but they were hoping to be able to overcome them. And perhaps very quickly, just to add 2 points. It was also very striking in the migrant testimonies that people had a lot of faith in God. So faith was something that was really mentioned very often. And this is something I found in earlier research when Central Americans told me that they felt abandoned by everyone, and that really their faith in God was all that was left. And so in the migrant testimonies that we collected as part of this research, it was also very striking that people felt there was really very little help for them available, but that perhaps with the help of God they would be able to make it into the United States. And the second point I wanted to make is that, of course, with the kind of research that we were doing, we were able to interview individuals we could actually identify and locate. But one of the things that also came through in the interviews was that, and also, of course, is something that has been shown in other research, is that migrants still make use of coyotes, of smugglers. And so the testimonies we were able to obtain were, of course, provided by those who hadn't traveled with the smuggler, but the migrants were aware of this option, and also of the prices that had to be paid, the fees. And so in many cases, it was clear that the smuggling fees had very much increased. So parallel to the obstacles that we find in Mexico and also at the US-Mexico border, that increases the need for many migrants to rely on smugglers, but also makes migrant smuggling into the United States a more profitable business. So the smuggling fees have really increased very significantly over the years. And so some of the migrants we interviewed, they had already migrated several times. So this is another research finding. And so from those who had previously traveled with the smuggler, we were able to determine that effectively the amounts had very much increased. But those who traveled irregularly to Mexico, to the United States, really had no more possibility to raise these funds in order to pay a smuggler. So this is, if you can manage to have these resources, either because you have property or because you have relatives, especially in the United States, who can help you with those resources, then it would be easier for you to get in the United States. But this is simply to say that yes, people, the migrants we interviewed had no favorable opinion of the Trump administration, but their priority was still either to survive economically, to make a living, to support themselves and their relatives in their country of origin, but also simply to find a safe place to live. So regardless of the perception they may have had of the Trump administration, they were able to put this aside and really make their survival the priority.
Thank you, Sonia. Yeah, that's why dissuasion doesn't work so much, no? And now, Gabriela, what changes? So we have to finish in 10 minutes. So maybe try to answer in less than 5, and then we can ask a question to Maciel. So what changes in Ecuador in the middle of the 2000s? What changed in Ecuador in the middle of the 2000s to change the discourse from rights of migrants to securitization? Yes. And someone added something. Could this have something to do with many Ecuadorians returning from abroad in the mid-2000s? Yeah.
Yes. Yes, thank you very much, Estefania. And yes, Julian, that is one of the points I was going to mention as well in my answer. So I think what changed, so at two levels, actually three levels, we can talk about very briefly the regional level, then the bilateral level, and then the domestic level. So first of all, regionally, South America started receiving these new flows, and I say quotation marks, I don't like that wording of flows, but new groups of people, new movements coming to South America, for example, Haitians, Cubans, and what they call extracontinental migrants or asylum seekers or refugees. So as in interlinked with this openness to migration and the arrival of these diverse range of nationalities, the rights-based discourse mutated a little bit into a migration management approach. So coming in hand with this management approach, the discourse focused more on smuggling, human trafficking, and so on, displacing a little bit the focus from the rights-based discourse. So that happened at regional level. Some academics, for example, if you would like to read about this, Sierani talks about control con rostro humano, or control with human face. So that happened at regional level. Now, bilateral level, Angostura crisis in the Andean region, Ecuador broke off relations with Colombia, so for a period of 2 years. So I think this also had an impact, most definitely. First, to use the enhanced registration program as a way to visibilize that the Colombian conflict was still going on, and the people were still in need of protection. And second, later on, retracting from that position because they had opened the door too much. So that in terms of the bilateral relations with Colombia. And thirdly, domestically, yes, as Julian points out, the discourse focused more on immigrants or Ecuadorians abroad, Ecuadorianos en el exterior, and retornados mainly. And also because Ecuador at one point removed all visas for entry to the country to all nationalities, this was in 2008, and it progressively added more nationalities to the list to this visa-free policy, that also brought the same trend from the from South America to the country. So we're talking about Cubans, Haitians, and extracontinental migrants. So in line with that as well, I think in that context is that these securitizing discourses and the policies that ensued took place. So yeah, I think that is it. And then after, yeah, around the 2015 on, the region starts moving towards the right. So then there is a new government in Ecuador trying to position himself in this debate, and he has already positioned, but I think this is all I can say about this.
Thank you, Gabriela. I have a question for Maciel and maybe for everyone else in the panel, if you find it relevant. Well, most of us, Sonia studied in the UK also, no? So we are living in the UK now in a very explicit hostile environment where the bureaucracy is like weaponized against us migrants. And in Mexico and in Central America, it's more like, yeah, human rights, and we're not doing anything wrong. So I was thinking, especially in the case of Maciel's research was more obvious, but I guess you guys have seen it. Do you think bureaucracy in Latin American migration has been like weaponized or is used violently against migrants, or is just because the countries are, you know, incapable of approving good laws that are efficient? Do you think it's, you know, on purpose, like the metering in the US-Mexico border with all these complicated rules, or here in the UK, which is clearly on purpose? Or, you know, what's your position on bureaucracy as a form of violence, I guess? Yeah. So, anyone, if Maciel doesn't want to start.
Sí, podría hacerme la pregunta en español, es que te entendí, pero no del todo, realmente mi inglés no es muy bueno.
Estás hablando de todas las reglas del Instituto Nacional de Migración y lo difícil que es, y aquí en Inglaterra tenemos el ambiente hostil para migrantes, ¿no? Entonces, quería saber si crees que esas reglas del gobierno de México son como súper malas a propósito, o sea, si en Latinoamérica utilizamos la burocracia violentamente contra los migrantes a propósito, o es como ineficiencia gubernamental, o tienes alguna posición al respecto.
Bueno, es complicado porque desde un punto de vista teórico se supone que la ley de migración es una ley cuyo propósito fundamental es garantizar la seguridad del migrante, incluso no solo del migrante que llega de manera regular, sino del migrante que transita por el país de manera irregular o que se quiere establecer en el país pero llega a un inicio como un irregular y después intenta regularizar su situación. Realmente la política migratoria mexicana se entiende como un amparo para es un amparo institucional y político para los migrantes, ¿no?, a la hora de reclamar sus derechos. Sin embargo, esto es desde un punto de vista más teórico, ¿no? Pero la práctica es la que evidencia que realmente sucede lo contrario. Más bien creo que es que hay una percepción desfavorable con respecto a la inmigración de manera general. Y me atrevería a decir que no es tanto por parte de la comunidad mexicana como tal, de la ciudadanía, sino como por parte de los funcionarios, que son los que de cierta manera vuelven operativos la política migratoria, ¿no? Son ellos los que realmente tienen como una posición, por lo que se ha podido ver, un poco desfavorable con respecto al migrante y desafortunadamente con respecto al migrante latinoamericano, ¿no? Se tiende a ver al migrante latinoamericano como un migrante que en términos generales tiene bajos niveles educacionales, entre otras cosas que son falsas y pero que están influyendo en la percepción de estos funcionarios que son los que, pues repito, hacen operativa la ley migratoria y los que de cierta forma conllevan a que no se cumpla lo que está establecido en la ley, ¿no? Y en mi estudio no lo analizo, pero sí lo puedo ver a la hora de realizar observación participante, que con respecto a los inmigrantes que provienen de Europa, por ejemplo, aquí hay muchos españoles, hay muchos mexicanos que son... vienen, practican la migración de retorno, ¿no? Vivieron muchos años en Estados Unidos y regresan acá, también inmigrantes de Inglaterra, canadienses y demás, y con esas personas el trato es muy diferente y tu proceso migratorio, ¿no? Porque llegas al INM, tratas de informarte y no te informan bien, no te explican qué es lo que tienes que hacer. A muchos latinoamericanos nos pasa, a mí me ha pasado. Y llega un migrante proveniente de Europa y el trato desafortunadamente es totalmente diferente. Pasa también, por eso es que en el caso de los sudamericanos, que tienen un aspecto, un estereotipo más europeo que el resto de latinoamericanos, con ellos también el trato es más favorable. Entonces sí son cosas que influyen en este proceso. Y no creo que es que la ley como tal sea una ley que esté en contra de la migración, sino que son los funcionarios los que hacen que al final pasen estas cosas. Que no se respeta del todo la ley, que en un inicio lo que pretende es garantizar la seguridad, la dignidad del migrante.
Muchas gracias. Tenemos 7 minutos más si alguna de las otras 2 panelistas quieren contestar esta pregunta o decir algo más.
Sí, muy rápidamente, creo que muchas veces son las 2 cosas, ¿no? En el tema de la, en el tema de la migración también. So I think when we look at Mexico, we can also see this, but also in other contexts. And I think there's more research now that is looking at these different contexts to look at what strategies are being pursued in order to make migration more difficult, but also to make it more difficult for refugees to reach other countries. And so if we look, for example, at the Mexican context, even though there has been a new migration law and there have been some institutional reforms, so these processes are ongoing. Even so, we can say that there are still institutional deficiencies, something we can attribute to technical deficiencies. Also, a problem that is often being mentioned by migrants themselves is that something is exists on paper, for example, the migration law. So migrants in principle also have access to education and health and housing like Mexicans. But in practice, migrants find this very difficult. So translating what exists on paper into reality is one problem. So you might say, well, perhaps this is an issue of training, right? Those who work for the state, who work in the bureaucracies and deal with migrants haven't been adequately trained. And so the implication would be that, you know, one day we can solve these problems and improve the situation of migrants. But I think also the research that is being done on deterrence strategies, on border externalization, on buffer states. If you look, for example, in the United States, the work that has been done by Todd Miller, who has written about U.S. empire and borders. Also, what I found interesting, the work by David Fitzgerald on refuge beyond reach, where he looks at different contexts. So you can also make this argument empirically. You would need to demonstrate that there's intent, you know, behind this. As Alejandra says, if, you know, the bureaucracy or perhaps the state as a whole is being used as a weapon against migrants, you need to demonstrate this empirically. But I think if you look for the evidence, you can make this argument that there are actually attempts to stop migrants. And so what I found interesting in the Mexican context, because the discussion for many years here has been about the so-called drug war. If you follow the argument by David Fitzgerald, you can even argue that the drug war is not simply an attempt by a series of desperate governments to reduce violence in Mexico, but tolerating this this violence is also a strategy in itself, because if you have violence along the migration routes, this is also another strategy of this buffer state. So it's not just a weaponization of the bureaucracy, how administrative procedures perhaps, or the use of immigration agents can make things difficult for migrants, but also it allows us to look at other strategies that make things more difficult for migrants and refugees to reach safety. So perhaps it sounds like a little bit of a stretch, but if you look at the panorama of violence and how the government after government in Mexico has been unwilling to implement a different security policy, this can lead you to make this argument that there is intent behind all this. So this is not simply a question of malfunctioning bureaucracies, but there's a series of a strategy that added together make it very difficult for migrants and refugees to transit and to reach countries of destination.
Thank you, Sonia. I think maybe we should finish because it's 6:43. Julian says that Wendy Vogt wrote in her book about arterial borders. It's a very cool book. Everyone should read it. Thank you everyone for coming. Thank you for the presentations. They were very, very interesting and amazing. Gracias a todos por venir y por las presentaciones. Estuvo todo muy interesante. I guess that's it.
Thanks, everyone.
Thank you.